Germany, working Cardiff. I do nothing but soft tissue work, coming knee and shoulder, probably about 40% shoulder and 6% knee. So that probably would get me kicked out here anyway for delving the wrong joint. However, let's crack on. So what I do intend to achieve in this talk is just have a brief run through the options available, look at the pros and cons of different options on a practical level, really, and discuss decision making, things like how we assess patients, how we help, what we can do in a real setting. I work in the NHS and the private sector, so you can see the pros and cons of both systems in terms of managing these problems. But as I say, the key thing really is to stimulate the effect. What it's not going to be is a comprehensive review. There's not time for that, and I'm not the man to give that talk. And it's also not going to be a detailed scientific discussion. Again, we don't have time, I'm not the man to give that talk. We could do a review of the literature, but again, like most speakers, you can find it to justify pretty much anything we do. So, probably do that either. So what we will do is run through a clinical case, and then just look at some of the things I did, and again, feel free to shout out, criticise, and so on. So, pretty similar story all the time, isn't it, really? 27-year-old accountant, fit and active. This isn't the patient, by the way, and that's not me. Those of you who are confused, Bill Stanish in Halifax. Patient twists the knee, continues to play football, manages to finish the game. Okay, so it's not an ACL type story. Knee's a little bit swollen the following day. The patient eventually presents about 3 weeks later with a little bit of pain, okay, fairly non-specific, predominantly medial joint line type pain. A little bit of an effusion, a bit of swelling, and describing some mechanical symptoms, not too locking, but some clicking, clunking, and grinding. So, quick assessment. Perfectly normal alignment, this is just on a visual assessment, small effusion in the knee, bit of medial joint line tenderness, but Murray's was negative in this case, and the knee was ligamentously stable. Okay, so they were seen in an NHS clinic, so you get some x-rays to my look pretty normal. Okay? No longer accused, fairly normal looking x-rays. Now that could have been where the story ended, as it would do in most cases. Also be a fairly non-specific injury. Quite often these kind of patients would get turned out to physiotherapy, sent off for rehab, and the story would go no further. But the patient said those magic words, "I have private insurance." So the next stage, of course, was to actually find out what the problem really was. So we get an MRI scan, okay? And I've only shown two sequences here, obviously, but ideally need to see more sequences, but we can tell from these sequences, although the meniscus here looks a little bit unhappy, there's essentially some area of damage to the articular cartilage here with some evidence of subconical bone bruising here on both these sequences. Okay, so the question is really, what's happened and what do we do next? Now again, I'm not going to go into any great detail, but as you know, articular cartilage gets injured every single day of the week. And if you only have occult cellular matrix damage, there is some matrix production, some repair. In a case like this, where you've got a chondral fracture, then chances are you're going to get some incomplete healing, and as you know, the basis of microfracture, and a lot of the other techniques that we have, is that if you have an osteochondral fracture or a fracture crossing the subchondral plate, then at least you'll get some form of fibrin block healing. So I think this patient, at this stage, I think this patient is probably in this group here. Okay, so what's the next thing to do? Now, this is again where it would be quite interesting to have a little bit of a debate. Later, should we go into these patients on the basis of an MRI scan alone and say, well, actually, there's something there, I'm going to go in, I've got a technique to treat this, or should we be doing a diagnostic arthroscopy first? And again, this will depend on your approach, and depending on whether you're going to use a cell-based technology to do this, or whether you're going to use an enhanced microfracture technique. Okay, so what are the advantages of arthroscopy? Well, the key thing is, obviously, as Ian was saying earlier, although the arthroscopy has a disadvantage, so all you see is the surfaces and you don't see the undersurfaces, it does have the advantage, which an MRI doesn't, but it's the only way you're ever going to get a good idea of what the quality of the tissue is going to be like. It allows you to look at the defect, it gets you a chance to look at the whole defect, and then you're removing loose cartilage, and more importantly perhaps, it allows you to look at the surrounding cartilage, because I think for me, one of the key things about managing chondral injuries is to make sure that you're not trying to manage an early arthritis where actually the whole internal part of the joint is about to fall apart. I always use the analogy to patients, it's like putting your finger in the dike. If the dike's basically strong, you've got that sort of dike story. It's a bit like putting your finger in the dike, okay? If it's the only hole in the dike, then you've probably solved the problem. If the dike is springing a whole load of holes, then actually an animal's just going to burst open. So it does allow you to look at the entire surface, and it's quite dangerous to go in and just do articular surgery without assessing the whole joint itself. So as you all know, this classification's been around for a long time now, but I suspect if I was to show every single one of you in this room a lesion, you'd probably end up with different interpretations of what the grading is on this, because it's a relatively simple grading system algebra, isn't it? So yeah, that's been around for a long time. I think we'd all pretty much agree on four. We probably all agree on what normal is, near normal. The in-between grades are a little bit variable, and quite often until you've de-rooted the defect and got rid of any loose flaps, you can't really define exactly what the classification is anyway. There's also the ICRS classification, which some of you may use, but the great difficulty, of course, is the ICRS classification uses similar numbers to the other classification system. So the problem is, if when you're operating, or somebody else has put it as grade two, what do they mean by that? That they mean it's an ICRS, they mean it's an outer. So immediately we've got a problem in terms of defining the lesion. Thankfully, this is a relatively easy one to define, because it's a rather large-ish lesion, that's probably about 2x3, something like that, sitting on the mediafemoral condyle. It's in plenty of exposed bone. This is after the loose flaps have been removed. They haven't used the wand like Ian's, and that's something I'd probably take away in the future. A little bit of damage to the other surface there as well. But it was an isolated lesion. Okay, so where do we go next? And there was the argument earlier on about whether or not this isn't the patient with the distal fixation, before you ask. Do you trust your eye? Are you happy to say, well, actually, you know, the patient's alignment is right? Or should, in these sorts of patients, particularly if you're throwing 2 grams worth of compound tissue at them, or whatever technique, should we actually be routinely teaching them with long wave use? Again, no doubt, again, very different opinions in the room. So, the difficulty here really is if that chap had gone down route 1, i.e., stayed in the NHS, not his MRI scan, that lesion may well have gone on to heal. I doubt it. But there is a possibility that would have gone to heal or become asymptomatic. The problem is, if you look at any cartilage injuries, they're all looking at a variable patient population, they're all using variable grading systems, and as we've already said, there's a significant intra and inter sort of error. What we really don't know when people sustain cartilage injury is which ones heal, which are going to progress, how quickly are they going to progress, if they are they going to become symptomatic, and then ultimately which ones we should treat. And I don't think anyone's got good answers to that. So personally, I like to try and pick winners because I like happy patients, right? And maybe I'm a little bit on the conservative side, but as we all know, the best patient, this would be the best patient really for cartilage type regeneration surgery. Ideally, you want a younger patient. You want an isolated lesion, as you know, you want the alignment to be reasonable, whatever reasonable means, or it needs to be addressed with an osteotomy. Again, the meniscus need to be intact or need to be addressed with meniscal transplant or meniscal implant, depending on your personal preferences. Ideally, finger in the dike, on normal surrounding cartilage, and ideally you don't want kissing lesions. And again, I'm sure a number of you in this room will put products and so on into kissing lesions. For me, it's technically difficult often, and the results of most studies are worse. What you don't want to be treating is early osteoarthritis. And I think, you know, at the age of 27, it's relatively easy to make that decision. When you've got a patient who's 45, 50, you start to get into a little bit of a grey area. And again, that's where we need to target these treatments a little bit more carefully sometimes, maybe. As for that, I don't want to teach my grandmother to suck eggs, but essentially, in these cases, like in some of the other cases, you've got to define your goals. Okay? Are you purely trying to treat the symptoms? In which case, you know, a good physio, rehabilitation, pain relief, maybe just going in and doing a debridement and unloading the area is the way forward. Or do we, I think the answer would be pretty clear in this room, actually want to think about reconstructing the defect in order to try and give the patient some long-term benefit and preferably give their knees some form of longevity. The key decision making here really is whether we're just looking at trying to reconstruct the condyle surface or whether we're trying to reconstruct the osteochondral area. And for me, that's two fairly distinct groups. So what's on the menu? Well, there's a whole load of stuff out there, isn't there? And something new seems to come out the whole time, ranging from either just sort of simple chondroplasty techniques, which are widely practiced by surgeons with and without interest in soft tissue knee surgery. And then you've got your marrow stimulation techniques, and those may be either a simple marrow stimulation, such as microfracture, or an enhanced marrow stimulation, which we'll talk about in a minute again, and you've already used these techniques. You've then got your options of osteochondral transplantation or chondrogenic transplantation. So I don't know a lot. What I do need is that you know you need all these for the process to be successful. Okay, you need cells which are doing their job. You need the structure within which the cells are going to be able to grow, and you need the growth factors in order for them to produce decent cartilage-like material. And I think small lesions, as is borne out by a lot of the microfracture literature, the structure probably becomes less important, and I think as the lesions get bigger, the structure probably becomes more important. So what's the evidence out there? The problem is, it's an absolute minefield. You know, from the Telegraph, wonderful, oh, it's great now, I don't take any painkillers, I can now wear high heels again, I've just booked a skiing holiday, which patients will come into you with, to the literature, which, as I say, can be used to support pretty much any technique you want, okay, to the NHS. I've used the Welsh NHS badge there because they're certainly not keen to throw money around like most NHSs, and therefore that's going to limit your choices in terms of what you can do in terms of treatment. You've got the various companies who will try and tell you that their new product is the best thing on the market and it's going to solve all your problems. You've then got the restrictions posed by people like the National Institute for Clinical Excellence, which is a very real problem, as you're all aware at the moment, and I'm sure everyone in this room probably had the email from BASC asking people to submit patient stories and so on to the nice review of these techniques. So there's a lot of people with a vested interest in the decision that you're going to make. However, again, being a fairly simple guy, I have a fairly simple approach to this. It's either a chondral defect or it's an osteochondral defect, and I would approach the two problems slightly differently. So let's look at the techniques that are out there. So, yeah, we talked earlier about afterstop washouts or a little tighter. Okay, and I think Ian had made a very good point of why a lot of techniques get bad press, because, you know, essentially a washout that is, we all agree, in an early arthritic patient, where it's simply a washout, you don't do more, is really unlikely to be successful. So abrasion arthroplasty clearly can get rid of loose bits of cartilage. However, the results are variable, and really there's no benefit beyond a simple debridement. I've never used power drilling myself. I think it's technically difficult. I think it's difficult to get the depth right of the drill, and I think you're likely to produce thermal necrosis. So the most commonly used technique, certainly my hands, would be microfracture. That would either be with a normal kick or with one of these motorized picks that are available now. But again, if we were to look around everybody in this room, I suspect everyone would do their microfracture slightly different. And I've certainly, I remember quite soon after I started getting a referral from one of my shoulder colleagues who was then doing some knee work as well, and it happened to have a video with it of the microfracture that he'd done. And you know, from the odd note, you'd have thought it was just a microfracture of a reasonable lesion. When you actually looked at it, there was no articular cartilage on the tibial surface at all, and he just got around and knocked some holes in it without any preparation or anything else. So I think we need to define what we mean by microfracture. And for me, what microfracture means is tidying up the edges, getting rid of the calcified layer at the bottom here, drilling properly into, or picking properly into the subchondral bone, and making sure that you don't break it, the bridges between the holes that you make, and that you know, get good surface coverage around the lesion. So we've got to define what we mean by microfracture, because I think sometimes it's very different depending on who does it. And the pictures ain't great, but this is an early case, which actually now I would probably put a clump of tissue on. But it's really just to prove the point, but I think you do need to do a little bit of preparation. I think Ian's use of the brain frequency, again, is something I'm certainly going to take away from this and do a little bit more frequently. So I wouldn't do a shoulder case without having brain frequency open, but most of your cases are probably looking for. So this review from Midhoff is a little bit old now. It's back in 2009, but it does summarise quite nicely some of the issues when we're looking at microfracture that are out there. Okay, so as one would expect, most of these things are predictable without doing a study. You look at the patients who tend to do better. I'm sorry if I'm going to project well, so I'll talk through it anyway, but it tends to be a younger patient, so under the age of 40. It tends to be short duration symptoms, under 12 months. Small lesions, so by this they're saying less than 4 cm². Patients who are less fat, patients who are more active, patients who haven't had previous surgery, patients who have good defect felt. Well, I don't think you need to do a study to say that, do you? It's pretty, it sort of, it goes without saying. But if you look at the review, and again, the devil's in the detail, if you look at the review in detail, there's 28 studies included here. Okay? It's a relatively large number of patients when you look at the total number of patients, which is over 3,000. But if you then look at the size in each individual study, the range is actually from 7, study with 7 patients, to 1,200. Okay, the average age, 39 plus or minus 10 years. So some of these techniques have been done at people the age of 65. I suspect a good proportion of those may well have been people with early arthritis. And the average follow-up varied from 12 to 136 months. And the lesion size, and again, interesting when you look at ranges, 0.1 centimetre squared, right, which that must be, I can't believe that's not a typo, because we're instructed to see that rather than actually treat it, up to 20 centimetres. So the problem is, you've got a massive range of patients these techniques have been done on. Again, as we all know from microfracture, short-term clinical results are often quite good. Maybe you can bribe them and do nothing would be quite good, but the short-term tend to be good, and then you tend to go to functional deterioration, certainly over 24 months. But again, you know, you look at the ranges here, you know, 75 to 100% good, but if you look at the range down here, you're talking 47 to 80% range in terms of functional deterioration. So it's not really a tight patient population or a tight group. The other thing to note is that the very variable creation of fibrocartilage and repair type tissue, and again, very variable revision rates. But the range, again, after 24 months, between 2%. 31%. The problem I always have with revision is it depends on your threshold, doesn't it? It's like new revisions or anything else. If you're one of these people who just always try and do something, the revision rates are always going to be higher. So I think we need to define when these procedures have failed a little bit better and decide when to revise them. So what do I do now? What I tend to do now, certainly with slightly larger lesions, is use this common tissue here, which is polyglycolic acid fleece. It's basically impregnated with hyaluronic acid, and the idea is that stimulates the cells which you might introduce into the area with microfracture to produce cartilage-like tissue. Again, does it have any evidence? Well, there is I'll come on to it in a minute, there is quite a lot of evidence to support it. There's a couple of ways you can do it, for those of you who haven't done it. The first time I did it, I thought I'd reclaim and do it arthroscopically. Okay, so complete arthroscopic procedure. So in that, make a hole, compare the defects, especially can, microfracture it, fleece on, cut the size, a few pins. It is fiddly, you can't get a nice repair, and certainly if you've not used this tissue before, I wouldn't suggest doing arthroscopy personally. I think it's better to do it through mini-open tissue. So essentially, defect, use a bit of foil or something in order to size your defect, put the fleece on, and then what I tend to use is either pins or tissue, depending on the size of the lesion. I'm very interested to see the fever stamp at the back, and I'm looking forward to Ian's talk at the end to discuss other ways of fixing the tissue graft. But I could talk through all these papers, I could show you all the evidence, but then equally one of you could come up and show all the evidence for MACI or ACI or whatever. So I don't think that's a helpful way of discussing it really, but I think for anything that you do need to have some evidence, and I know there are a few other products that are coming out now which are being encouraged to use, which certainly don't have the same depth of evidence behind them. This is my one slide on ACT. Now, I'm not going to even talk about it because I've never done it, I've never used it, I don't think it's cost effective, and I'm sure there are people in the audience who could have exactly the opposite discussion with me. But certainly, if you look at comparative costs, certainly the NHS is significantly higher. And to be honest with you, although ACT and ACI is better in younger patients, you know, people will report good results from them, and will report good fill, and you'll have histology saying better cells produced and everything else. Bottom line, for everything I've read, and again, please somebody feel free to pipe up and tell me otherwise, is that there are serious concerns about the cost effectiveness of the procedure. And certainly in the current climate, although I think we should be continuing, I'm very happy, and we should all be supporting Tim and people who wish to continue doing it, I think it really needs to stay, for me, it should stay still in the research realm and in the control trial realm, but rather than going around there, because the costs are excessive. Then we've got osteochondral transplants, and again, looking at the management of osteochondral lesions. Can anyone in here get hold of large osteochondral fresh allografts? Yeah, I think logistics is pretty. So I think for most of us, for the big lesions, this is probably it's not really technically feasible. So let's say I think using autograft is logistically easier. Obviously, you've got no risk of disease transmission. Tissue is limited, and you've got the risk of donor site morbidity. And certainly for smallish condyle defects, osteochondral defects, I'll tend to use this procedure. Still, I usually backfill the holes with whatever I've taken out of the defect, but I'm sure many of you were involved at some stage or other with things like TrueFit and other synthetic options. Mark and I certainly put quite a few in Cardiff as a part of the study. Results were variable, we published on it. I have to say overall though, the regeneration of fill was pretty poor for me compared to using the patient's autologous tissue. So I think certainly that's the past of synthetics, but again, new waves of tissue are coming along all the time. whether that be a purely synthetic option, whether that be a hybrid, cadaveric and synthetic option, you know, we'll see. There's a new RFX plug out there, there's loads out there on the market. It's just a question of which way you should jump. Again, that's why I'd see a group like this maybe trying to do it in a slightly more organised way than just having a go, which unfortunately happens all too often. The important thing to realise, though, when we talk about any sort of cartilage management is actually the quality of evidence. And it's slightly worrying that we're putting in large amounts of expensive kit when there is such poor evidence. The vast majority of studies on all these techniques, whether they be microfracture, ACI, MACI, OATS, methodological scores are often very poor. If you look at the vast amount of evidence, it's level 4 evidence. Okay? Very few good quality randomised controlled trials. And what's slightly worrying as well, for me, is if you look at the way that the outcome of a lot of common procedures are assessed in the literature, quite a lot of them actually, virtually none of them have a re-exploration second look. Okay? And a heck of a lot of them actually don't even have an MRI scan, a follow-up MRI scan in assessment of the outcome. So you're basing it purely on the clinical stage or grade of the patient's function. Once you throw in placebo effect, the fact that there may just be some effect from having punctured the subcomal plate, I think a lot of the studies are fairly meaningless. And I hope good quality evidence is certainly something that we need to work on. So for what it's worth, and it's, you know, this is what I do, doesn't mean it's any better than what anyone else does, it's just what I do. Patient goes through a bit of a screening first. So firstly, I would tend to go for young patients. You need to have somebody who's obviously relatively active. You need to make sure that their alignment's reasonable or is correctable, preferably a focal lesion, preferably either trochlea or a femoral condyle. I tend to shy away and look forward to talk later about to the management of patella lesions. I tend to shy away from the undersurface patella, but trochlea quite happily do. You need to obviously assess the ligaments in this guy. Do you need to do any form of ligament reconstruction, meniscal surgery? But the key thing, I think, is that people need to buy into the rehabilitation, because for any of these procedures, what you don't want the person to do is go away and walk on it straight away. And actually, they may need to buy into, as Ian was saying, the fact that they may not be able to return to play rugby or play football or whatever it is. So I think patient selection is absolutely key. If it's a condyle lesion and it's a small lesion, I tend to treat it certainly primarily just with a microfracture. Again, 2 centimetres is kind of a cut-off, but it does depend on the patient and what happens when you've removed all the loose material. Luckily, we've got common tissue on the shelf, so it's relatively easy to use it if we need to. If it's an osteochondral lesion, I tend to do an OATS in a small procedure, in a small lesion, slightly larger lesion, then again, tend to try and use some bone graft, pack the base of it, then put a common tissue on the top of it, because I think in this group where you've got large osteochondral lesions, unless you're going to go to metal, the choices certainly in the UK are relatively limited. I think bulk allografts or larger allografts, fresh allografts, then that would certainly be a route that I would go down and give the option. So what did I do? It's a fairly straightforward case really. So all of this, tidied up the edges, sized it, put a common tissue on, didn't use pins in this case, and put some fibrofluid over the top of it. And this is an MRI scan that was taken 6 months after surgery. There's quite still a little bit of bone bruising underneath, but that's not uncommon. You punch great big holes in the bones, it's probably not that common at all. But actually, in this particular case, there was quite good cartilage fill over the top of it. I think, to be honest, most of the ones that I've done, the MRIs have been pretty good. I've had a couple where I've scoped the cartilage. It doesn't look like an articular cartilage. The cartilage, it looks better than the fibre cartilage that you get from a microfracture, but it certainly doesn't look like nice glistening, spongy, articular, highly cartilage. So, in summary, and I think we're going to have a demonstration of the common tissue in a minute, and I think the important thing is actually to have time to discuss rather than eating rabbits on. There's a lot of options out there, okay? It needs to be based on the lesion itself, the patient, the resources available, and a lot of it's about the surgeon's philosophy as well. You know, how do you believe these things should be treated? But I think more evidence is needed, particularly in terms of cost effectiveness, because I still find it difficult to justify spending 12 grand of the NHS's money on a patient with